in a car with Dom Jolly.
Driving, that's another thing I love.
Do you, yeah, I'm gonna say, do you like driving?
Oh my god,
have you driven?
Like, road trip is just my favorite thing in the world.
You should come out on tour with us and drive 10 hours a day.
Do you know what? I'd love it. I would actually, I just like driving. I love it.
Would you like a lion's fruit salad all the way from Cleckheaton in Bradford?
Of course, who wouldn't?
Yeah. There you go.
Oh fuck, he's gonna stick in my teeth out. I'm not gonna say anything tonight. This is a really bad thing to do for an interview. You're listening to fruit salad. With Nova and Dom.
Your phone's playing some tunes?
Yeah.
What are you listening to at the moment then?
Spotify playlist. And just when I see something I like,
I send you a lot of crap now.
You do?
Yeah, but I don't know if you're listening.
I do.
You miss a CD.
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I miss the solidity of, I miss not owning my own things. Okay, well this is a band I love, the Boxer Rebellion. Do you know the Boxer
Absolutely
Rebellion?
Absolutely amazing.
I fucking love them. I met them because I was just hassling so much and I used them on Trigger.
Like I was hassling you?
Huh?
Like I hassle you?
Yeah. This is Diamonds. You know this one?
Oh my gosh, it's been been placed on so many shows.
That's the problem, that's how they got big. They got put on, you did as well though, didn't you? It's normally Grey's Anatomy and that sort of thing. And CSI and all those ones. Well, I love this song.
Well, that's how we got signed originally.
By what?
One of our demos from the first, well, one of the tracks from the first album.
It got placed on what?
CSI New York.
Oh, you're off then.
And Atlantic Records, and a subsidiary of Atlantic Records, Chop Shop Records, happened to hear that, and they was like, right, yeah, we'll sign you.
That's cool.
And then from there, we had, obviously, music placements on Grey's Anatomy, 16 and Pregnant, Teen Mom.
I'd Teen Mom.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's what you want, isn't it? Well, that's why people hear it.
Well, you got to think about it, Dom. In America, how many people watch TV?
No,
as well as this country. But
also, there's nowhere anymore. Like, there's no, you know, there's no Top of the Pops. There's no MTV. Doesn't really, to me, doesn't exist anymore, really. Yeah. So that's where you see it, isn't it?
Absolutely.
That's where I see a lot of my stuff in films. And I think, fuck, what's that? I Shazam it straight away.
One of the best inventions ever, Shazam.
It's incredible, yeah.
Especially like you're travelling around as well, if you don't
know. I hate that moment when I know the dialogue's about to come in and I'm trying to get the fucking Shazam on like that to do it. It's great.
I mean, we touched on it earlier, didn't we? I mean, how me and you kind of met, would you say virtually?
Yeah.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? Obviously, me kind of just reaching out. It was a long shot, wasn't it, on Facebook and stuff. And 9 times out of 10, no offence to kind of people in the public eye, don't really reply.
They're tossers. I don't get that many people reaching out to me that way, but when they do, I know it's because something I've done has like meant something to them. And that, what was great was because you're in a band, like when I heard your stuff, I was like, fuck, I love your stuff as well. Mm. And I love it when bands get in touch with me and then I can use their music as well.
You got some great songs on the Trigger Happy soundtracks.
Oh, I
unbelievable.
Just,
I mean, House of Love.
I love the House of Love.
What's that Sid Barrett one? Is it Television?
That's Television Personalities. Oh, that's probably the most
scene,
obscure
that
one.
That scene with the small eyes. Hello, like Mr. Dude.
Would you like a French fancy?
Yeah.
Do you know Scanners?
Never heard of
it. Oh my God, this is a song called Salvation. I fucking love it. I really like girl singers. I love this. Went to the sea, but the tide was out. Bit Polly Harvey, PJ Harvey.
Yeah, yeah.
The wind was cold. Waited around for no one's about. Got off my spirit till my head took hold.
It's that.
Yeah.
That's the hook. That would go straight to Trigger that.
Yeah.
Just that. It's just those moments.
You can
moments
really pick out your melodies, can't you?
It's just those moments in songs that make you think, fuck, it's just like a drug. Like, they make your skin go. And I hate people that don't have that. Some people don't. Like, you put a song on you love and you just go, shut the fuck up, listen to it, and they're chatting through it. And you're like, what? I mean, I'm talking through it, but.
Which of the bands have you seen live you think, wow, that was an impressive show? I mean, I'm a huge U2 fan.
Do you know what? It's so funny you say that. Okay, so I hate that people hate U2. And it's like Coldplay. I'm like, you know what? Fucking respect. They didn't do the British art school thing where they make a success and then decide, fuck that, I'm going to make all my fans hate me. Mm-hmm. U2, like, you know, normally when you see a band, you're like, oh my God, they're great, but I wish I could have seen them in a little club. Weirdly, I think U2, the only band where they almost work better, like when they're in a big, amazing place. I was at Live Aid, so I saw that breakthrough moment when they did Bad, which is one of my favorite songs by them anyway, off Unforgettable Fire. Mm-hmm. And they started riffing and went into Ruby Tuesday and Walk on the Wild. So it's fucking amazing. And he's just, I think they're incredible.
They don't just perform musically.
Yeah.
It's a theatrical performance.
Oh, yeah,
do you know what I mean? I mean,
yeah.
I saw Joshua Tree recently. And the latest one, Songs of Innocence.
Yeah.
Which was inside Manchester Arena.
Yeah.
And it was like literally a living room show with you two.
But yeah, you two definitely would be up there. I mean, obviously Live Aid was phenomenal. Bowie, I'm just obsessed with. Prince, if we're talking about big names, like Prince, I'm just totally obsessed with.
Yeah. When darkness
falls. So I use this on, like, getting people to put a band, they're like doing Vox Box on people and getting to put a bandage over it. And it was just, I didn't like Gene. Gene to me, like a sort of Smith's knockoff, but this song is fucking incredible.
It's Olympian
is the name of their album,
I think.
I don't really know anything else by them apart from this, but I love this song.
So did you come across these songs, like, how was it something, because obviously this is before Spotify, iTunes, and
well, if you think about it, Trigger Happy was like my first album, you know, like, in the sense that you've been collecting these songs all your life, and suddenly you're like, fuck, I've got all these songs I like. So when I came to later ones, I'd kind of used my best ones. So it's, you know, I suppose it's like a DJ, like, you've got your favourite things and you want to play them and stuff, and I try to put as many of them in. I just have moments when I listen to music, and people I like have the same thing, where you just listen to it and it just takes you over, mm-hmm. and you have to just fucking play that one bit. So every bit of music used in Trigger was the specific bit I loved, and often the edit, I'd let a joke run to fit the music rather than like to fit the joke to fit the music, you know what I mean? So sometimes there'd be a much longer thing just because I wanted it to use the right bit of music.
But you were so precise in the placement of that specific song. For example, Star Sailor, Tie Hands. Oh my gosh, Star Sailor. Yeah. But even like the Embrace one, All You Good People.
I loved Embrace. People hate Embrace. I don't know why.
They're unbelievable.
They're
literally like 5 minutes from us. And it's
really?
Oh, the great guys.
Are they?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, this is Bradford.
Bradford.
Isn't New Model Army?
New Model Army?
Yeah.
The Cult?
Get
that song on.
When I was in a band, that's what we did two covers, A Forest by The Cure and She Sells Sanctuary.
What were you in the band?
Singer, obviously. I can't play anything.
Dance as well?
Eh?
Did you dance?
No, we were goths. We just stood there and looked really unhappy. This is it. This is going to be like that scene in Wayne's World. You ready?
That snare drum.
Yes!
I mean... Fuck, yes! I wish we weren't in traffic.
Yeah, no.
Who cares?
We got to stop and you got to leave now because we're not going to beat that.
What would you say is the best piece of advice you've ever been given and the worst piece of advice you've been ever given?
Well, I remember my dad. My dad and I didn't get on at all, but when I told my dad, because I like languages and I speak some languages, and he said, what do you want to do? And I said, I think I want to be an interpreter. And he said, don't be the interpreter, be the person who's being interpreted. And I thought, that was probably him just being a bit, make some money, but mm-hmm. I thought that was quite good. It was like, don't aim too low, basically. The best advice I was ever given was by Robert Smith from The Cure, if I'm going to name drop. And he said to me, don't ever do anything for the money. And I thought, well, that's great. And then I suddenly thought, didn't you sell first pictures of you to Kodak? And he went, yeah, and I went. And he said, but if you need the money, do it. So it's like, you know.
Wasn't he in your living room at 3 o'clock in the morning?
Yeah, oh my God. So I grew up, you know, like, I was really into The Cure. I was a goth, you know, and I just had him a poster on my wall and stuff. And then when I did a documentary, a sort of spoof documentary on my life after Trigger, I was at that stage where you could ring someone up and like we needed someone to be a cameo as the best man at my fake wedding. So someone rang up Robert Smith, and turned out he was a big Trig Abbey fan, and he turns up at the office, and I'm just like fucking freaking out. I come out, shake his hand, and he's really nice, and he says, where are we doing this? I go, Marylebone Registry office. And I said, we've got a van. He said, well, I've got a driver, like in a limo. So I said, great. He goes, do you want to come with me? I'm like, trying to play it cool, you know. I'm like, yeah, right. So I get in the back and I'm just like, fucking hell, like, I'm in the fucking car, Robert Smith. Play it cool. And we get to the Marylebone Registry office, and it's like a big busy road, mm-hmm. but it's just got a little slip that you can park off where they drop brides off and stuff. So we stop and I'm just so in the zone. I open the door of this car and a fucking lorry just takes the door, rips it off, and the car moves around like this. Robert Smith's flung around like that. And you could see him thinking, is this a fucking hidden camera job? I go, I swear it isn't. So anyway, like, he's really cool, you know. So we carry on and we do the filming while this sort of steaming wreckage of his car is there. I'm so embarrassed. And then I do a show, a spoof chat show. And on the pilot, I asked The Cure to come on. And they came on to do my pilot, wasn't he, a broadcast? And at the end of it, Robert Smith goes, that was fucking brilliant. Should we go out for a drink? And I'm like, okay. So we go to the pub, and I'm in the pub with Robert Smith in Covent Garden. And we get pissed. And then it's like 11:30 and he's like, pubs are shutting. And he goes, oh, you know, the guy's going to drive me back later out of town, but let's keep going. Where should we go? And I'm like, where the fuck do you take Robert Smith? So in the end, I go to my place if you want. So we get into his car and it's the same fucking driver. And he's like, so we drive there. And as we get, it's like 11:30. I've just had a kid. So my wife's at home, like, baby. And I'm suddenly like, fuck, I've got pictures all over my flat of me looking like him. So it's like that Alan Partridge thing. I'm running up and I'm ripping down these things. And he comes into my flat, and Stacey's like, where the fuck have you been? I go, Robert Smith's in the kitchen. She goes, what? I go, Robert Smith's in the kitchen. So she comes in and goes, hello, Mrs. Smith. Then I take this picture of him going like this in my kitchen. I'm just like, it's so amazing. Anyway, so, and we get more and more pissed, and it's 3 a.m, and I'm playing him Baby Bird, and I'm playing him stuff. And then I suddenly think, I gotta fucking work tomorrow. Like, is Robert Smith, like, is he gonna leave? Like, he can't stay here. So in the end, I had to kick Robert Smith out of my house. I love Tears for Fears. Not this one, though. But put Seeds of Love on, because that's a great overproduced one. But this is amazing, overblown.
Again, production though. Oh,
it's incredible. But this is like, they took 2 years to make this. They went mental. Oh, yeah. Great choice, though. This is like Beatles ELO.
Yes.
Could you be squeaky clean? What the fuck? It's my wife.
Sounds like you're on the move. Where are you?
Yeah, I'm on the way to Rocky, but I'm being interviewed in my car and playing music.
Hi, Mrs. J.
Hello. Well, if you need any inside information, just give me a call.
No. Bye. See you later.
Okay, see you later. Bye.
Listening to Tears for Fears. Sowing the seeds of love, the seeds of love. Feel the need, talk about it. You're a warrior, I am. High tide, Jesus. Follow your path. And the love train rides from coast to coast. Love the most. I'd like to say all the people in this traffic jam are going to see the Rocky Horror Show tonight, but it's probably a football match.
When did you get into music then at a young age? Obviously born in Lebanon.
My brother and sister both had, like, they were really into the Rolling Stones, Bowie, Dylan. So that's where I started. Like, I was just obsessed, and I'd play all their stuff. Then I had a flirtation with Supertramp, who I still love. And then I bought I bought Queen Night at the Opera, and it all went from there, really. Weirdly, people think that I'm, you know, because I can dress as a snail and approach people, and that I'm not. It's my worst fear is coming on stage as me. I'm not actually that confident in that way. So tonight, for instance, Rocky Horror, mm-hmm. it's perfect for me, because I'm not me. But people sort of go, oh, it's dumb, but it's not me. I'm playing a character, I'm a narrator. So I'm totally relaxed.
Do you get nervous then?
Yeah, fuck. I mean, yeah. First night of Rocky in Brighton, because, again, you'll see my role is so weird, because I'm dealing with the audience. Mm-hmm. So, like, when we're in rehearsals, there's nothing I could do. I could just read. But till they get you, you don't know whether you can do it. And 10 minutes before we went on, I honestly nearly did a Stephen Fry and, like, fucked off to Bruges. I was honestly, like, I was getting in a cab. I was so nervous. But then when I went on, I was like, fuck, I can do this. And it's such a rush.
Just a piece of teenage mind. You series of the podcast, don't you?
It's good. So I did. I did one called Earworm.
Yeah, which we heard on tour while we were.
Did you?
Yeah, yeah.
And I've got Stephen Jones from Baby Bird, who I think is a fucking genius. Like, he was stuck with that big hit, "You're Gorgeous," but actually he just makes fucking album after album in his basement, and so he gave me loads of his stuff, and so I used that as the sort of base for it. And then I'm doing a new. We've just been bought by Audible.
So how do you do it with you and Matt?
What, the earworm?
Yeah, the earworm. You ring people. You've got a microphone.
Yeah.
Speakerphone kind of thing. And you just like kind of right. We're just going to go for it.
Yeah. So I basically
have
say
you got like a rough kind
it's
of
a bit like Trigger. So it literally would sort of say, so what should we do now? And I go, how about a pet shop? We haven't tried a pet shop. So he goes, all right. And then so he looks at a pet shop. And then we always go north because everyone's so much nicer. So, like, we normally go to York. So we ring up York, a pet shop. And then as we're ringing the pet shop, it actually works exactly like Trigger Happy did. Trigger Happy was all about me trying to make Sam laugh. Like, he's filming. So a lot of the shaking was Sam filming. And I'm just trying to show off to Matt, really. And so I love that they answer. And I've got to be funny. I've got to try and think of something. And then you just go with it. And sometimes it doesn't work. Sometimes it's amazing. Sometimes we have an idea. So we had one that I really liked where we were selling people names. So we were saying, yeah, can I speak to the Gary of the house, please? And then we go, obviously, in our surveys...
So when she lost her head, we
yeah.
You are!
I said, well, in our surveys, a lot of people find they're not happy with the name Gary, and we've got a special deal at the moment on Thomas, or a thing. She goes, what? I think you're being fucking offensive. What's wrong with Gary? I just love all that. So I'm playing in Sunderland, and I don't like football, but I've been watching Sunderland Till I Die, which is fucking amazing. And there's that song on the soundtrack, on the titles.
In a band called the Lake Poets, but the young kids called Marty Longstaff.
On the river where I used to build the boats.
Gorgeous.
What a voice, eh?
By the harbour wall, the place you love the most.
Nice.
I'll be there soon. If you could see me now.
Perfect piece for that documentary, isn't it?
Oh, it's amazing. Whoever made it, clearly that's a real passion project. You can tell they grew up in Sunderland, just got the place.
Characteristic passion through something like football.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
I love the way that... It's also, I love seeing dads and sons kind of relate. You know, like, they're not... You know, we're not a very emotional race.
Yeah.
You know, we're not very good at that. But you can see it when they both score and they're like, yes! And then they're like, all right, son, I love that.
Yeah. Follow any sport or anything like that?
Yeah, I'm obsessed with cricket because I'm posh.
Yeah. No, cricket's great.
I love cricket. And the first test match I ever went to was Headingley, Leeds, with my dad. And it was, I don't know if you know enough about cricket, but it was Botham's Ashes. And it was basically the most famous test match in the world, 1982. And we followed on. After 3 days, we were going to leave. And then basically both of them got 149 and we won... And then won the Ashes. And literally, it was like, it is probably one of the most famous test matches ever. My dad said to me at the end, he said, that's like walking into a casino the first day and winning big. Like, he said, you should never really get to another cricket match because it'll never get like that again.
Wow.
It was incredible.
You got two kids, yeah?
Yeah.
How do they find what you've done, what you do, and obviously, like, stuff like I'm a Celeb, for example?
Well, it's weird. When I was, obviously, Trigger Happy, they were too young, luckily, because, like, you just don't want your dad running around as a squirrel. And then I think the first thing they were aware that I did was I'm a Celeb. And I was really worried about that because, you know, you don't want them being bullied at school and, like, if I'd have behaved badly or done something. And they came out to Australia and they had a fucking ball. And I came out and, like, Jackson was wearing a Happy Mondays t-shirt and was best friends with Sean Ryder's kids. Right. It was like... So, yeah, that was really good.
How was that, the jungle?
It was amazing. I loved it. You see, that's the other thing. It's like, you know, reality shows are supposedly naff and you're not supposed to do them. But because of what I do... I make shit up, and I riff, and I hate scripts. And so there's nowhere really for me to do anything like Trigger Happy. You know, like, if you're a normal comedian, you go and be an actor or do whatever you want. But that doesn't interest me. So I love reality shows because I love watching them, because I love trash. But also I just love getting on them and just, like, thinking, right, you get thrown in and then you're like, what the fuck are we going to do?
Are the kids and Mrs. Jolly seen the show yet?
So they came to Brighton, and on purpose I didn't tell my kids what it was. I wanted them to have the full... So firstly, like, when people start shouting from the audience and stuff, you could see them thinking, what the fuck? But then they slowly realised that it was, you know, what was happening. And then there's a bit at the end of the show where basically I get my trousers ripped off and I'm wearing fishnets here. And my 14-year-old boy just turned to my wife and just went, what the fuck? It was, like, amazing.
I could literally... could just drive around a bit more.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm loving this. I mean, obviously, I love talking about myself because I've got an ego, but I love just driving around playing music.
But it's great connecting through music.
Oh, but I'd love just playing just music talking, to someone that actually loves it as much as I do. Is this it? I'm lost now. This is an amazing theatre. What's it most famous for? Sid James, who was in Carry On films, died on stage here. I mean, I'd die on stage every night, but he literally had a heart attack.
Did he do a Tommy Cooper?
Yeah, and he died on stage. This is the car park that we're not supposed to park in, but I have every night and no one stopped me yet, so...
Perfect.
That was really fun. That was awesome. Nice drive in every day. Could do with that. There you go. I mean, this is what my kids saw and was just like, fuck, Dad's going through a change.